New Hope TV, your encounter with God.
Hallelujah. Last episode we heard, and we were not able to complete that portion of the scripture, about the attributes of God. When God promised to give His Son, He says, the word of God in the book of Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6 says, the government is upon His shoulder. That means the whole, to see there is the perfect unity or harmony and peace and prosperity all over the world is upon the shoulder of Jesus. He says, it is a responsibility that I am giving my Son, whom I am giving it to you, giving to the world, giving to the people. And He is the one who is going to decide and determine the destiny of the world. So He says, the government is upon His shoulder. He is. Then the different attributes. We heard about wonderful. We heard about counselor. Counselor is the person from whom you get advice. You get sound advice. That is why when you read the word in the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7, it says, God has not given us a spirit of fear. Fear comes when there is, absolute confusion in your life. And the epistle of John says, fear is torment. Torment because you don't know what to do. You are running helter-skelter. You don't know, I have a problem. What do I do? Where do I go? Who do I seek? Because you are totally confused. And this is also referred to very clearly in the book of Matthew chapter 9. When you read verse 36 onwards, God says, Jesus, the word of God says, Jesus had compassion on them because they were weary and they were scattered like sheep having no shepherd. So they were weary, because they are so confused. Where is my resting place? Where is my water? Where is my grass? I'm just giving an example of the sheep. Because they had no shepherd. Today, many believers are like that. They say that they are sheep, but they don't know the shepherd. They don't know the true shepherd, Jesus. They are after many, many hired shepherds. People who come there for some wages. Today we know many of the shepherds who are leading the sheep are all doing it as a profession or a vocation. It's rightly called a vocation. Under the Income Tax Act, profession and vocation and all are part of business. Vocation is something that you have decided, you have a talent for that. You can be a vocation to be a priest. Because normally it's referred, he had a vocation and he became a priest. Or she had a vocation and she became a nun. Vocation. It is a profession now. Because you find, I'm not saying this to hurt anyone's feelings. People don't become priests and nuns, many, many cases. Not because they have a calling from God. They see it as a good revenue earning source. They hardly have a call. And practically you'll find they are all sources of revenue. Probably they justified saying the Levites were not given any land and they were to live out of the tithes. Today there are many people who put their hand also in the tithes and offerings that are there. So it's become a business. So the council, this is, they are weary because they are like sheep having no shepherd. Today I can assure you many, many churches or fellowships of believers are in the same condition. Jesus says, they are weary. They know that what is being done is not right, but they have no guts to stand against it. Neither do they know where to go. Where else to go? They don't want to go from the pan into the fire. Frying pan into the fire. There is a saying that. Because they are ignorant, that of them only, the book of Hosea says, my people are being destroyed for lack of understanding. Understanding of what? Understanding of God's word. Book of Matthew chapter 13 says, the seed that fell on the wayside is snatched away by the devil because they did not understand the word that was spoken. Today I pray that you will understand. That is my prayer when we started this session. That God will open your mind, the mind of your understanding, that so that you will be able to comprehend the word that God is speaking into your life. and that God will touch your heart, that you will receive these words in faith and nurture it in faith. Receive it with joy, nurture it in faith, and see the glory of the word. So this counsel, my dear brother, my dear sister, I want to tell you, the only counsel that you can rely upon is a counsel that comes from the Holy Spirit. He's a counselor. He's a teacher. So your whole Christian life must be fashioned around God's word. The revelation that the Holy Spirit will give you about God's plan and purpose of your creation. So he's a wonderful God. He's a counselor. The word of God is counsel. Next is, he's mighty God. Oh, what can you say about that? Mighty God. When he's God, he's mighty. Hallelujah. There is nothing that can come against him. Elohim, God Almighty. Amen. So it is this God that the Father is giving to us as a gift. So, like I told you earlier, a king is a king with the subjects. So if there are no subjects, there is no king. Similarly, Jesus Christ is given to us as a mighty God. And unless you receive Jesus into your heart, you will never be able to experience the might of God. Because definitely there is no decrease in the might of God because you personally did not accept Jesus. But God gave Jesus unto the world to reveal the might and the glory of God. It is up to you to be part of the church in which or through which this might and the glory of God is going to be revealed in time. He is in charge of whole of creation. If he were not in dominion and in control of the whole of creation, Jesus could never have asked the storm to still be still, and it would be still. Actually, the disciples then wondered, what type of a person is this? Who is this that the wind and the storm obey him? That creation obeys him. It obeys him because he is God, and that God is mighty. So, my dear, that is why you and I need to understand that when you invite God into your life and into your problem, you don't have to worry about the answer or the result of your issue. Because once God takes over, the every attribute of God comes into play. Such a beautiful example in the book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. We find it was a situation where Jehoshaphat the king had a problem. The problem was three armies were coming against him to destroy him. And he, being a very sensible person, he was not a person who was, not aware of the facts and the circumstances. He knew that he had by no way he could destroy, he could fight against the three armies, the combined armies. So he knew that his recourse is not in his own ability, but in the ability of God. A God who will never let him down, leave him nor forsake him. So he commanded a fast, he prayed, and he declared to the Lord. He said, Lord, we do not know what to do, because we are helpless, but our eyes are toward you. Our eyes are toward you in prayer, in supplication, in surrender, in humility. Today, that must be your benchmark, my dear brother, my dear sister. When you are faced with a problem, don't try to handle it yourself. Come to the Lord. And that is in verse 12, 2 Chronicles 20, verse 12. Verse 15, the whole situation changed. God sent the prophet and told the people, do not fear, do not be dismayed. You just stand still and see the victory that I am going to give you, because I am getting into the field. He says, this battle belongs to me. This battle belongs to me. So will you, my dear brother, in faith, allow God to come into your battles? Allow Almighty God to step into your shoes and fight your battles? Surrender everything into his hand. And that surrender is so beautifully described. And how your attitude is that surrender should be is so beautifully described in a psalm where it says, as the eyes of the servant is upon the master, and the eye of the maid is upon the mistress, our eyes will be unto you, O Lord, until you have mercy on us. Until we are going to be persistent. We are going to be persistent until you have mercy. We will not change, take our, the focus of our eyes from you, because you are the source. You are the only one we can rely upon. You are the only one who will and can bring a solution to the problem that we are facing. If you declare that, my dear brother, my dear sister, it will be like the same big problem that the blind man faced when he came to Jesus. And Jesus asked him one simple question: do you believe that I can do this? And he says, yes, Lord, you can. He said, I want my sight. He said, what do you want? I want my sight. And Jesus asked him, do you believe that I can do it? He said, yes, Lord, you can. And the reply of Jesus is the commandment of God. He says, let it happen to you according to your belief. Today I want to tell you, my dear brother, my dear sister, that if you invite Jesus into your life, and if you in faith receive him as your Lord and your Master and your King and your everything, then I can tell you, whatever you believe, it will happen in your life. Again, the book of Mark chapter 11, God says, if you have faith, and then you say to this mountain, be removed from here, and do not doubt it, then whatever you say, it will happen. Say, proclaim, believe. Because all this is behind, or behind all this is the mighty hand of God. That is why, again, I told you earlier in the earlier episode, book of Mark chapter 16 verse 20. When my words are being proclaimed, I think I'll read it out to you. I mean, you need to understand God's word in its right sense, as God meant it. Nobody needs any interpretation of the word, my dear. You just read it. Word of God says in the book of Corinthians, the simplicity and the purity of Christ. No, you don't need any degree in philosophy or degree in theology to read God's word. God's word is so simple and pure. All that you need is an open heart, a believing heart. As we normally pray that, you know, during our talks, due to paucity of time, I do pray before that God will give you a teachable heart, a loving heart, a praising heart, a believing, obedient heart, a believing heart, and a thankful heart. So we need to believe God's word. Again, like I told you, the book of Mark, chapter 16, verse 20, says very clearly what happens when you believe God's word. It says, and they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, not only the person, but the words that they preached, and confirming the word through the accompanying signs. Amen. So when you preach God's word, there will be wonders and signs appearing and manifesting the glory of God. When Jesus stood at the tomb of Lazarus in the book of John chapter 11 verse 40, he says, did I not tell you, if only you would believe, you would see the glory of God. Then further he says, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus came forth. His spirit returned. My dear brother, believe. There may be different dead situations in your life. Allow the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord, to come into your life and rekindle that hope that you have. The hope that you have in Jesus will never disappoint you. The book of Romans chapter 5 verse 3 to 5 says very clearly that you might go through tribulation, but tribulation will give you perseverance. You will go through perseverance, but that perseverance will give you hope. Character. And that character will give you hope. And that hope will never disappoint you, because the love of God, the knowledge, the revelation of the love of God has been poured out into your hearts by the Holy Spirit of the living God. Another very interesting thing that you need to understand is hope. Just like your Savior, your hope is a person. Hope is not an emotion. Hope is not a thought. Hope is not even a belief. Hope is a person. And if you don't believe that, then turn with me to the book of Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 1. It says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God. Okay, now listen. God, our Savior. So God, our Savior, is a person. And Jesus Christ, our hope. So our hope is also a person. Savior is Jesus Christ. Hope is Jesus Christ. That is why it says, your hope will never disappoint you. Because your hope is Jesus. Jesus will never disappoint you. That is why the word of God again says in the book of Romans chapter 10, that those who believe in me, I will never put them to shame. They won't have any opportunity to be disappointed. Next, attribute of God's word in the book of Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6, that he's an everlasting father. Everlasting father means there is no beginning, no end, no end to the father. That is why he says, John chapter 1 verse 1 says, in the beginning was the word was with God, and the word is God. There is no end for God. Actually, there is no beginning also. He is always there. So that is why God is not constrained by time or space. There is no restriction for God. That is why when you read, it's very interesting when you read the word in the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 4. You might think that you are born after your parents got married, of course, definitely, and they had a relationship and then you are born. But as far as God is concerned, you as an individual is in the plan of God even before the world was created. Even before your father and your mother were born, even before they were married, you were already there in the plan of God. That is why Ephesians 1:4 says that you and I were, I mean, let's read that. There's nothing like reading God's word, because then there will be absolutely no doubt in your mind that whether I am paraphrasing it correctly or not. I will read it out to you because it's so important to understand that you and I are not a fiction of something that have created by our parents. You and I were in the plan of God even before the world was created. It is like this. Ephesians 1 verse 4 says, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So he has chosen each one of us. Even before the world was created, you and I were in the plan of God. Like I told you earlier, God does not have space or time. For God, everything is there open. Before creation and the end of creation, all one slate, one painting, you are there. He knows everything about you. Well, you as a person can do something only after you are born. But God knows what you will do even before you are born. And accordingly, he has prepared, he knows your mind even before you are born. So he prepares the way for you to accomplish that. There's a desire in your heart. He provides the power or the way to accomplish that. That is a typical example, or a very good example is in the book of Romans chapter 9. When you read, Esau and Jacob were both in the twins. They were both in the womb of the mother. But God says, even before they were born, I hated Esau and I loved Jacob. Hated Esau for what? He had not even been born. He did not commit any sin. But God, in the space, in the time, the painting, or in the history of Esau's life here on this earth, even before he was born, God knew that one day he will sell his birthright as the elder son for a cup of porridge. He knows that even before he committed the crime. And he also knew that Jacob is a deceiver by nature, but one day he will have an encounter with me, and one day he will tell me that I will not leave you unless you bless me. And he knows that without the blessing of God, he cannot do anything. And therefore, God decided to give him a new name from Jacob to Israel. We heard about that. So God hated Esau before he was born. God also loved Jacob even before he was born. It's not fatalism. It is this grace of God that has enabled you and me to come to God. It has enabled you today to listen to this message. And I pray, God, that he will touch you, that he will open your mind so you can understand the word that God is speaking to you, and he will touch your heart. Yes, so you receive it in joy, nurture it in faith, and the glory of the word, the seed, of which is the word of God, will manifest in your life. So when you say everlasting Father, there is no change. So what he has decreed, what he has commanded, nothing can change. That is why God says very clearly that heaven and earth will pass away, But my word will never pass away. It is everlasting. Time or circumstances don't change the plan and purpose of God revealed in His word. So if He says that by His stripes I am healed, whatever be the situation that you are in, whatever be the gravity of the illness that you are going through, if you believe in God's word, and according to His plan and purpose, of course, you will be healed. And every other covenant promise, because God is working amongst the covenant promise, which is revealed in His prophetic word, and He says, and I will work amongst the word to see the fulfillment of that word, which will only be for the glory of God. So He is an everlasting Father. His word does not change one bit. That is why, my dear brother, my dear sister, I dare say that you can put your life on God's word. Because God very clearly says, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. It is so reliable that it will never change. Even if heaven and earth, even if man changes his word, even if the whole universe changes, my word will never change. So today, it is that faith that God expects you to have. Everlasting Father. If God has said, He will do it. And one beautiful example of that is in the book of Romans chapter 4, verse 20, 21 and all that. When you read, the word of God is talking about Abraham. Look at his situation. In the book of Genesis chapter 12, He called him out and He said, I will bless you. Genesis 15, He said, I will give you a son. And through that son, you will have descendants. And the number of the descendants will be what you cannot even count. It will be as much as the multitude of stars in the firmament, and as much as the sand in the seashore. There will be the number of your descendants. But still there was no son. You cannot have descendants unless you have a son. And at 75, the age of 75, God gave him this promise. Till the age of 99, he never saw the son. So naturally, you and I would be sort of influenced to give it up, give up on the promise of God, but not Abraham. Abraham knew from one example that happened once that God called him out to bless him, and he obeyed God's word. He was in a land of idolatry. He was a very rich man, but he left everything, not knowing where he is going, but knowing very well who called him. It is a knowledge of God. And that knowledge of God, my dear brother, the book of John chapter 17 verse 3 says, you have eternal life. Eternal life is to know that only true God and Jesus Christ whom He sent. So when you and I have stepped out in faith, you have actually stepped out into eternal life. As so well said in the book of Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2, He says, you were in darkness, but God has now brought you into His marvelous light. And once you are into that marvelous light, your status changes. He says, you are once not a people, but you are now my people. You once never received mercy, but now you have received mercy. It is only the mercy and the compassion of God, my dear brother, my dear sister, that you are here, you are listening to this message, that you have accepted Jesus and you are obeying God's word. It is only the mercy and the compassion and the love and the grace of God upon your life. It is not your ability. No, no, no. By your ability, you will fall. The flesh profits nothing, but the Spirit gives life. The Spirit of the living God enables you. That is why 2 Corinthians chapter 12 says, all that you need is my grace. Even in your weakness, my power, my strength will be manifested. Hallelujah. So, everlasting Father, His word never changes. My dear brother, my dear sister, I will urge you that if you have a word from God, you can rely upon it. Let's say in the book of Hebrews chapter 6, the hope that I told you earlier, the hope that we have shall never disappoint you. Romans 5:5. That hope is referred to in the book of Hebrews chapter 6. He says that is a peg upon we hang. Our hope that everything, you know, our comfort is in the hope of God. So today I pray that you will have the revelation knowledge or the revelation, the faith to believe in the revealed word of God, which says that His word will never pass away. It is everlasting. As much as the Father is everlasting, Father, God is the Word of God. So as far as the God is everlasting, there is no change. The Word is also everlasting, and there is no change. That is the everlasting Father. Next, and the fifth is Prince of Peace. See, one of the fruit of the Holy Spirit described in the book of Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23 is love, joy, peace. Of course, the others are patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, and self-control. 9 are described that there are much more. Don't tell that only these 9 are the fruit. It's not fruits, it is fruit. You and I are the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Are you with me? Because you and I are born out of the incorruptible seed, which is the Word of God. When you read the word in the book of Peter, it says very clearly that you and I, being born again, we are not born out of the sperm of man, but we are born, reborn, born again out of the incorruptible Word of God. And therefore, you and I will abide forever. Just like Jesus, the book of John chapter 1 verse 14 says, the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld the glory of the Word. So Jesus was born from the Word of God. Similarly, you will find that you and I are born out of the incorruptible Word of God. That is why when you read 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 23, it says, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible through the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. So if you're born from the incorruptible Word of God, which lives and abides forever, then you, as a born-again person, being the fruit of that Word, will also be live forever. And you will live forever with God. There is no end. There is no destruction. Are you with me? I hope you are with me. So it says, one of the attributes of the fruit of the Spirit is peace. Today man is, this is something which evades man. Peace is something which is seldom found in the lives of people. There are so many things that rob your peace. Maybe it is your health issue, your financial issue, your emotional issue, your relationship issues. There are so many issues that man is going through which is robbing him of his peace. But Jesus Christ has come into your life to reconnect and to re-establish that peace. That is why he is called the Prince of Peace. Today we need to pray. Especially in India, there would be peace once again. There's so much of turmoil, political and other economic turmoil. We should pray for peace. Peace at the borders of India, especially with China and Pakistan. We should pray for peace. Peace all over the world. There is political, there is so much of riots and so much of violence all over the world. But Jesus is in control. Today, if man would humble himself and would confess his sins, God will heal the land, heal the people. Once again, he will establish peace. Peace. If you want peace, my dear brother, you and I should go to the Prince of Peace. He is the one who can bring real peace into your life. And that peace comes out of not fear. Fear torments, like I told you earlier. But peace, 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7 says, he has not given you a spirit of fear, but of love, of strength, of a sound mind. A sound mind to accept the counsel of God, and then the Prince of Peace will rule and reign over your life. Amen.